please mute yourselves and do not turn on your video during this session. And also in the chat box, you can put your questions only at the end of the lecture. So now we are heading towards the first presentation of today. And for introducing today's speaker, may I request the convener, Professor Atri Deshmukhia, to take over. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Revolina, for a nice start. And I would like to welcome back all the participants to the second day program of the webinar. And I hope everybody has enjoyed the last day's program. Today, we have Dr. M.M. Ali, who is working as a senior scientist for Center of Ocean Atmospheric Research. Ocean Atmospheric Prediction Studies at Florida State University. And he's there since 2015. Dr. Ali is a renowned researcher in this field, have lots of recognitions and prizes in his bag. And essentially, his research interest on ocean atmosphere interaction with special reference to wind stress and ocean heat content, remote sensing with special reference to satellite altimetry and scatterometry, ocean eddies, mixed layer dynamics, ocean processes for strategic applications, special reference to temperature and sound speed profiles, and sonic layer depth, and many other. So he has a good teaching experience also. And I hope, you can always, everybody now have the access to profile of the speaker, so you can have lots of information regarding him. I don't want to waste your time with this brief introduction. I request Dr. Ali to please address the gathering, share his thoughts with the audience. Over to Dr. Ali.
Thank you, Professor Atri, for your nice introduction. I'll be talking today on the global warming, climate change, and sea level rise. And because of this sea level rise and temperatures, most of the observations are coming from remote sensing point of view, particularly as Dr. Atri has already mentioned, satellite altimetry gives the sea level rise and information on sea level rise. So to start with, it is already introduced. Now, why it is important to understand the climate change. Climate change is happening, and probably I feel that it cannot be stopped. Only thing, it can be mitigated. So to understand what are the causes of climate change, probably we'll try to mitigate it, we'll try to control it, even though we cannot make it standstill at zero. And similarly, if you know what are the consequences of climate change, what is going to happen if climate is going to change drastically in the same way it has been changing so far, then probably we'll understand this importance of mitigating the climate change, try to reduce it. And this also will make us weather ready. I mean, we should be ready for the future changes. Suppose climate is going to change drastically in the coming years, then we should be prepared for that. Not only for human point of view, even for agriculture point of view, we should be prepared for that climate change. For example, if the weather is changing too much, if the temperature is changing too much, or humidity is changing, what are the consequences in agriculture? What type of seeds are required for that purpose? So these are some of the things we can understand if we try to understand what are the consequences of climate change. So we should try to adapt the climate changing the whatever change climate is changing. We should try to adapt it, and also we try to possibly reduce its acceleration. It is climate changing with a high acceleration. So okay, we cannot control it totally, we cannot make it zero, but at least we'll try to control its acceleration and reduce its impact on the weather and local weather and even agriculture and environmental point of view. Now coming to, I think I will be a little bit talking a little bit in fundamentals also, so that if there are some students who are fresh to this topic, they will also understand. So to start with, what is climate change? Climate change refers to a statistically significant variation. It should be, you cannot say that today some temperature is has increased. For example, 2 days back, some TV fellows came here and then said that temperatures have increased. So within this 2 days, because of the less rainfall and less cloudiness, temperature of local climate here, where I am presently okay, has, I mean, increased drastically. That cannot be called as climate change. Climate change refers to a statistically significant variation. There should be over a long period of time, typically of a decade or so. Then only it is called climate change. So variation in either the mean state of the climate or in its variability persisting for an extended period of at least a decade or so. That is what is called climate change. Suppose yesterday's temperature and today's temperatures are different, quite different. That cannot be called as climate change. Similarly, climate change may be due to the natural internal processes, which I feel, I mean, its contribution is very less, or the external forcing, or to persistent anthropogenic changes in the composition of the atmosphere or in land use, land cover. So the second part of it, like anthropogenic changes, are mostly causing the climate to change very drastically and with a high acceleration. Now, coming to the global warming and climate change scenarios, so we can see the melting of glacier ice, ice caps, thermal expansion of seawater, when the temperature increases, when the sea surface temperature, not only sea surface temperature, even the subsurface temperature of the ocean increases, thermal expansion takes place, and because of that, your sea level will rise because of the thermal expansion, and even the change in evapotranspiration also will occur because of the change in the temperatures. Change in snow accumulation also will have an impact on that. Because of the temperature, snow may be accumulating or maybe melting also, and which melting of ice, I mean sea ice will, sea ice may not change by melting of the land ice, land or the ice, I will show in the subsequent slide. It may also cause the sea level rise. And now ultimately the what is happening is more high tides and coastal erosion. Are you able to see my cursor? Are you able to see my cursor? Anyway, more frequent high tides and the coastal erosion is likely to occur, and more frequent floods are also likely to occur because of the climate change, and high risk of even drought is also one of the possibilities of the climate change. Now coming to the change indicators, what are the change indicators? One is the glacial retreat, the second one is the increased sea level rise and reduced Arctic sea ice cover. The change agents are, what are the change agents? Greenhouse gases, biomass burning, and change impact, extreme events, food security, water resources. These are some of the impact changes. I will talk more about the greenhouse gases in the subsequent slides. Now, what are the anthropogenic factors for climate change? One is the greenhouse gases. They scatter and reflect the solar radiation and infrared radiation from the Earth surface, scatter the whatever radiation, incoming radiation is coming from the sun, that they will scatter, and because of the scattering, the impact of temperature rise will be less. But because of the trapping of the infrared radiation, your temperature is increasing. Now let us just talk about the greenhouse gas. I think most of us know, I mean, I am talking this to the very young students who are still in the budding stage. What happens is, the temperature with height decreases up to at least troposphere. Even though we are going closer to the sun, which is the source of heat, the temperature as you go high, it decreases. And that is because the atmosphere, our atmosphere is transparent to the shortwave radiation, which is mostly coming from the sun's radiation, but opaque to the longer radiation. Once the sun, I mean, Earth gets heated up, it, because of its own temperature, it emits radiation that goes in the form of long wave radiation. So now what happens is the greenhouse gases, for example, carbon dioxide, it traps, it doesn't obstruct the incoming radiation what is coming from the sun, but it obstructs the outgoing long wave radiation. In the long wave radiation part, it obstructs the outgoing long wave radiation which is emitted by the Earth's temperature. So as a result of that, the source of heat to the atmosphere is not the sun, it is the Earth. The radiation which is going from the Earth is the source of heat to the atmosphere, and as a result of that, because as you go away from the Earth, the temperature decreases. So because of that, your these greenhouse gases are very important to understand why the temperature is increasing. If there are no, of course, greenhouse gases are very important. Without greenhouse gas, what would have happened is there would not have been trapping of the longer radiation, and as a result of that, the atmosphere, present atmosphere, would have been much more cooler. I mean, which is beyond our control to monitor. It would have been so cooler, like in the polar regions. And because of the greenhouse gases and trapping of the longer radiation, which is going from the surface, our temperatures are maintaining a little bit in higher temperatures. And similarly, aerosols, they scatter and absorb the solar radiation, infrared radiation, change the physical and chemical properties of clouds. And you know, for cloud formation and the formation of rain, aerosols play a very important role. They act as a condensation nuclei. Without aerosols, the atmosphere, I mean, water vapor in the atmosphere would not have condensated to the water droplets and form in the form of rain. So because of that, aerosols are also important in the formation of clouds and the rainfall. And similarly, land use change, deforestation, urbanization. Because of the deforestation, the temperatures are rising because we don't have much of greenery or forestry, then the temperatures are increasing. So deforestation should be curtailed to maintain our natural environment. Similarly, urbanization again a part of the deforestation, and again construction of the buildings. And because of the construction of the buildings, our albedo of that atmosphere is changing, and because of that, your climate is also getting impacted. Now, these are the various components of the global climate system. If you change the hydrological cycle, is there, you know, hydrologically is water coming from the atmosphere to the earth surface, then runoff, then again evapotranspiration, and again a circle completes, and that is what is called the hydrological cycle. And the various components are coming into picture: atmosphere, and then precipitation, evaporation, evapotranspiration, also atmosphere ice interaction, terrestrial radiation. There are so many human influences also, like cutting of the trees or construction of the buildings, and then construction of the roads, which affect your albedo, as I already told you. So these are some of the earth's components of global climate system. Now, what is global warming? How it is happening? See, natural forcing only. I'm presenting here three scenarios. One is the natural forcing only, and then second one, anthropogenic forcing only. These are all through models. And then natural plus anthropogenic forcing. Now, for example, if you see only the natural forcing, for example, if you see here Krakatoa volcanic eruption, which has happened in 1883, which is one of the dangerous volcanic eruptions. Because of that, the temperatures have come down drastically. You can see here, and these are model results, and the red one is observations. Of course, there is, if you consider only the natural forcing alone, then it is not exactly matching. There is not a good match between the observations and models. And similarly, if you consider both natural and anthropogenic forces, the match is very good. Whatever observations are showing, model results are also showing the same thing. So we should be very careful in giving inputs to the models, so that it will give a right projection for the future climate change. Now, if you see here, there are some particles in the atmosphere. What happens to them? They will cool the atmosphere. They remain in the atmosphere only for a week or so. But because of the particles, of size of the particles, whatever radiation is coming from the sun, it will be reflected back or scattered. And because of that, there will be a cooling effect. If you talked about the greenhouse gases, it is a warming effect. And these greenhouse gases remain in 100 years. Yesterday, one speaker was telling that if I make some changes in the greenhouse gases now, it may not affect me. It may affect the coming generations. So we should be very careful. If we are careful about our generations, we should be also careful about increasing the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. It gives a warming effect to the atmosphere. And I already told you that greenhouse gases are very important. Without greenhouse gases, our atmosphere would have been something like freezing temperatures. No, it is very important. But too much of good thing is also bad. So we should be under, these greenhouse gases should be under control, and we should be able to control the greenhouse gases so that our climate will not be getting warm faster. Now coming to the global temperatures, blue dots are in the annual averages, and the red is in the 5-year averages. they are increasing, drastically increasing. If you see here from 1860 onwards, you just see how it is increasing, and this increasing very drastic in the recent past. Even though it is a little bit increasing, but here, you know, very sharp increase there from 1880 or 1990 onwards. So we should try to control this this temperature rise. And also in IPCC 2001, different models have been run with different inputs. And these are the rising temperatures, temperature change in different modeling scenarios. If you see here, the bars indicate, show the range in 2100 years, what will be the temperature ranges here. And different models show different increase of temperatures. Through models, these are all model results with the different scenarios. So now we should see what type of scenario fits in the future and how it is going to change it. Okay, now this RCPs, you know, this will be under consultation pathways. There are four pathways here. We are showing only the two pathways, RCP 2.6 and RCP 8.5. If you see here, in IPCC ER5 projected global average surface temperature changes in the high emission scenario, that is RCP 8.5, which is in red, here temperatures are increasing very drastically. It is, they are going up even 4 degrees or 4.5 degrees Celsius increases, it is showing. If you take the scenario of RCP 2.6, which is a blue, and it is increase in temperature is not that alarming. So now it all depends upon what type of atmosphere we are going to create in future so that this climate change is going to in practice. And similarly, projections of global warming, different models are here given on the left side, different models are given and different scenarios are given for the increase in temperature. All the models are showing increase in temperature. Of course, some models like CCS or NIES model is showing very high increase in temperature, whereas the NCAR PCM model is showing a little bit less. But nevertheless, all the models are showing increasing temperature in the future by 2100. So this is very alarming. We should be cautious about this. Now, fossil fuels use power and transportation is the greatest source of greenhouse gases that cause global warming. Fossil fuel burning, it creates a lot of, because of the cars or even fossil fuels or even burning of the petrol or chemicals, in the chemical factories, or the, they will increase the greenhouse gases, and because of that, the heat which is going away from the earth is getting trapped, and because of that, your temperatures are increasing. And now you see here atmospheric carbon dioxide, annual cycle is shown here in the box down below. And whereas the temperature is, CO2 concentrations, carbon dioxide concentrations are increasing, drastically increasing. And this is very alarming situation. And you know, one of the main particle greenhouse gases is CO2. It constitutes about 76%, and whereas methane constitutes only about 16% of the greenhouse gases. And because carbon dioxide is one of the major global parameters are greenhouse gases, so we should try to curtail the production of carbon dioxide. We should try to minimize it if we are very careful about the increasing scenarios and increasing temperatures. And this, for example, if you see here different parameters like how CO2, NO2, and CH4, how they are changing the global scale, spatial scales. CO2 is on the global scale and it has very high risk. And if you go to the total air results, it is having a cooling effect, whereas black carbon and tropospheric parameters or CH4 or CO2. CO2 is having the highest risk, and it works on the global scale, not only on the smaller scales. And now annual carbon emissions by region-wise. For example, you see here, even though USA is having the highest CO2 per year, this is a million metric tons of carbon dioxide per year. And USA is showing the highest increase of CO2 emissions. whereas our India, we are showing a less, even though it is increasing, but it is still very less compared to other countries like Eastern Europe and former Soviet Union's Soviet states. Now, what is to be done here is we are not concerned only about what is happening in the local scale, because this greenhouse gases will affect globally. So all countries should work together to reduce the carbon dioxide emissions to the atmosphere. We cannot say that we will maintain the same level and you try to reduce. We cannot. No country can say that. Now, coming to the population and the CO2 rising together, they are rising together. If you see here on the left side, this is the increase of population, how it is increasing, and CO2 is also increasing. If you draw a line, a correlation between the world population versus CO2, R square value is about 0.97. That means there is high correlation between the increase in the population and the increase in the carbon dioxide. So what is happening is, I'm not saying that population should be controlled, but use of throwing of the carbon dioxide to the atmosphere should be curtailed, it should be minimized. Now, greenhouse effect, I already told you, sun is a source of energy. It energy comes from the sun, but atmosphere is transparent to the sun's radiation, whereas it is opaque to the radiation getting effect, emitted from the Earth surface. Now, as a result of that, atmosphere is transparent to the air, and Earth heat is started from going back to the space. So if greenhouse gases are more, what is happening is the heat which is supposed to go back to the space is getting trapped in the atmosphere itself, in our atmosphere itself. And as a result of that, our local temperatures are increasing. Our atmospheric temperatures are increasing where we are living. And as I already told you, greenhouse effect is an essential environmental prerequisite for life on the Earth. Otherwise, the temperatures, present temperatures will be having free at freezing level. So this is very required, but too much of anything good is also bad. So we cannot say that greenhouse gases are important, but they are very good for us, and we will go on increasing it. We cannot say that. We should try to minimize its projections. Now, coming to the greenhouse effect, what happens is solar radiation is coming here. It gets the Earth warmed up, and because of that, it emits back the radiation. And this emitted radiation, which is used to showers to go back to the space, and it is getting trapped in the atmosphere because of the greenhouse gases. This we should try to control it and try to minimize this. Suppose you want to go for extreme events are increasing, you know, nowadays extreme events are increasing, heavy rainfall events are increasing, even though the water rainfall is decreasing. So we should try to minimize that. Now, why the surface is getting cooled? The surface cools by radiating heat entering upward. The warmer the surface, the greater the amount of heat energy that is radiated upward. So now, why it is getting emitted backwards? It is because of the Earth's temperature. Because the Earth emits radiation in the longer form, longer radiation, this longer radiation is getting back, so it's supposed to go back to the space, but it gets obstructed because of the greenhouse gases, and it is not going to the space as much as it was supposed to go. As a result of that, our temperatures are increasing. Now, how much heat is this? This is the temperature anomaly in the y-axis on the left side, and it is how it is increasing, how much heat is getting increasing. You just see here, heat content is amount of heat content, temperature anomaly is increasing, and because of that, the heat content is also increasing. Heat content is what? It is a product of temperature, mass, and heat capacity. You know, water has the highest heat capacity, and because of that, heat is getting absorbed with the ocean. That is one positive point of part of it. So most of the heat is getting absorbed with the oceans, and heat capacity is increasing. And because of the increase in heat capacity, is also changing the cyclones, intertidal cyclones, and you know, in the recent past, more intertidal cyclones are more. And intensifying cyclones are more compared to normal cyclones. That means if the temperature starts with category 1, it goes on, faster to become category 4 or 5. And then that is what I am saying. More intensifying cyclones are coming more. And that is because of the heat capacity of the ocean, it is increasing. And because of the heat capacity, energy for the cyclones, food for the cyclones is the latent heat released from the ocean surface. Because of the sea surface temperature, not only sea surface temperature, the amount of heat that is available in the ocean, that is called heat content, is more. And because of that, more intensifying cyclones are also coming. This is one part of the extreme events, which is the main topic of the workshop. Now, what happens with the heat capacity? Just take two balloons, one filled with just air, and try to heat it with some stick. It will burn. It will not sustain. But if you take another balloon, which is filled with water, and try to heat it, it will not burst, because already the heat, whatever heat you are supplying to the balloon, with filled with water, it is getting absorbed with the water inside the balloon, and it is not getting burst. So that is how the heat content and heat capacity of the oceans are very important. Now, the oceans have 1,000 times the heat capacity of the atmosphere. Compared to the atmosphere, ocean's heat capacity is much more longer. It is almost 1,000 times higher than that of the atmosphere. And as a result of that, most of the heat that is increasing, temperature that is increasing, is getting absorbed by the ocean. That is the positive part of it. But unfortunately, this heat content, if it is going on increasing like this, the more intensifying cyclones, more disastrous cyclones will be, number of more disastrous cyclones will be increasing in future. Now, for example, the oceans are the Earth's heat capacitors. They absorb the heat and then maintain the temperature. Now, for example, if you see here, the atmospheric heat content is very less, almost closer to zero, very less, whereas the ocean's heat capacity is shown in the green. It is increasing with the coming years, whereas atmospheric heat content is not that much drastically increasing. About 20 times smaller, Earth's atmospheric heat content is about 20 times smaller compared to the ocean heat content. Now, coming to the most of the heat goes into the oceans, I already told you the amount of heat absorbed by different parts of the Earth's climate system for the past 40 years. If you see here, oceans absorbs about 84% of the heat capacity, whereas atmosphere absorbs only 4%, continents 5%, and ice 7%. If you see, compare the numbers here, everything is single digit in the atmosphere. Continents and ice, whereas in the oceans it is 84%. You can just imagine how much of heat is getting stored in the oceans. Now, this is another important slide here. It shows the ocean currents, global currents. If you see here, these are the ocean currents, and the direction is given by the arrows here. And what is the advantage of that? This heat content. You know, the equatorial regions get more heat, and the polar regions get almost negligible heat. So the most part of the energy which is coming from the sun is getting absorbed in the equatorial regions. Now, what happens to the amount of heat that is getting absorbed in the equatorial regions? This heat is getting transported to the polar regions from the because of the currents in the ocean. If there are no currents in the ocean, suppose we presume that there are no currents in the ocean, now whatever heat is getting absorbed here in the equatorial region would have remained there itself without getting transported to the polar region. As a result of that, our equatorial regions would have been much more warmer than what they are presently now. And similarly, polar regions would have been much more cooler than what they are right now. But because of this currents in the ocean, this heat is getting transported, because when oceans are when water is very good transporter of heat. So this heat gets transported to the polar regions from the equatorial region. As a result of that, the temperatures which are as of now are maintained. Otherwise, the polar in equatorial regions would have been much more warmer, and the polar regions would have been much more cooler than what they are right now. This is how the oceans play an important role in transporting heat from the equatorial regions, source of the solar radiation, to the polar regions where there is no heat at all almost. Now, observing, coming to the global sea level rise, we talk about the Holocene sea level, which is in different years in the last 1,000 years, how it is happening in the last 9,000 years, how the sea level is increasing. And if you come to the present sea level rise, it is, you know, here, I mean, particularly this red is in the altimetry era, where we have observations of altimetry instrument measurements also. You can see here almost the whenever the there are both observations and the satellite altimeters are available, there is one-to-one match is almost there. And you know, the sea level is increasing. Now, as a result of the sea level rise, I'll come to it, what happens in the coastal regions will be immersed in the seawater, and because of the sea level rise. And it is overall increase is 2 millimeter per year. And if you come to the recent years, I'll be showing in the next slide probably, it is 3.3 millimeter per year increase in sea level rise. It is, even though it is millimeters, it is a small amount. If you take the entire global oceans, if you take the entire area of the volume of the ocean, even 3.3 millimeter per year increase is very cautious. We should be very cautious about that. Now, if this is the sea level rise, how it is increasing? You see here, if you draw your overall curve, it is increasing in this, it is 0.8 millimeter per year. But if you draw into different parts, see here, almost in the recent years, the increase is 3.2 millimeter per year in about 2006 or so. Yeah, 2006. 5 or 6, but in recent, for example, if we consider March 2020, just few months back, it increases 3.3 millimeter per year. So this rise in sea level has to be curtailed. This can be curtailed only because of two factors. One is by controlling the temperature, atmospheric temperature, reducing the temperatures, increasing temperatures, and second thing is by reducing the land ice melt. Ice melt should be reduced, then we can stop this rise, very heavy rise here. You can see here, this rise is very drastic. In the recent years, sea level rise is very drastic. Now, what are the major contributors of the sea level rise? One is the addition of heat. You know, when the temperature increases, your volume increases, and because of the volume, sea level also will be increasing, because it cannot go down below the ocean's bed. So naturally, the sea level has to come up and it has to increase. One is the addition of heat, and the second one is the addition of fresh water. The fresh water which is coming from the glaciers and the snow melt and all, that also is contributing to the sea level rise. And then now, because of these two factors, the total sea level is coming. Now, how to observe the sea level? One is addition of heat. You know, there are some floats in the ocean, they are called argo floats. What they do is, these are something like ocean observation systems. They go deep in the ocean, maybe up to 10 kilometers. So, of course, you can program it to go up to only a few kilometers also, or a few meters also. They go deep to the bottom and they move along with the current. Horizontally, and they pop up after some time. When they pop up, they take the measurements of temperature and salinity, and from that we can talk about the what is the addition of heat in the ocean. Heat content of the ocean you can estimate using the temperature and salinity observations. Now the second one is addition of fresh water. This can be obtained from a GRACE mission. GRACE was already there, and then GRACE follow-on also is there. So from that, this satellite, we can measure what is the addition of fresh water to the sea. And then from the altimeters, I have written Jason here, but any altimeter can give the total sea level rise. This total sea level rise, what is measured by the altimeter, is because of the addition of the heat plus the addition of fresh water. I will talk a little more about the GRACE mission. It's a very good concept. I'll talk about it even in the subsequent slides. Now, if you talk about that argo floats, they there is a slow descent up to 2000 meters. This can be programmed up to 2000 meters or 4000 meters. It can be programmed. They go up to 6 hours at 10 centimeters per second speed. They go very slow and they drift along with the subsurface currents. There are two advantages of that. One is we can also get the subsurface currents in the ocean, because we know where this float has gone down into the ocean, and after some time when it pops up, we can measure where the turbo float is observed, and we know the latitudes of this, and from this we can almost estimate the subsurface current drift in this from this turbo float. And second one is when it goes up, when it pops up to the surface, it collects the temperature and salinity profiles from this depth of about 2000 meters at 4000 meters. It collects the temperature and salinity, and when it pops up to the surface, it remains there for a few hours and it transmits to the satellite, and from the satellite again we'll get back the information of this temperature profiles. This is how it works. And there is one more concept which has come after the after a few years of the installation of this arbor floats, that is you can also estimate the rainfall. So what happens is when the rain falls on the surface, it creates some noise, and that noise is can be recorded by the Argo floats, and from that we can roughly estimate what is the intensity of the rainfall. From this sound, what the raindrops create in the surface, from this sound is getting recorded by the Argo floats, and this will be used to estimate the amount of rainfall. This is another advantage of this Argo floats. Now, in 2007 itself, we could have Argo is able to provide the first time realistic estimates of the global distribution of heat in the upper ocean. In the 2007 itself, now we have many more floats, but in the 2000, I think it started in 2002, Argo float started in 2002, and by 2007, we were able to map the entire global oceans, and now also we're able to do that, continue this these observations. Now, another measuring the total sea level, I told you that satellite altimeter, Jason is written here, any altimeter can give the total sea level rise in the global oceans. Total sea level rise, what I mean by that is because of the heat, increase in the heat content of the ocean, temperature of the ocean, and second one is because of the melting of the ice or snow. Now let us talk a little bit more about the satellite altimetry, because this is very much useful in estimating the sea level rise. Altimeter measures round trip travel time, okay, and also the slope and strength of the return micro radar pulse. So let us now talk about the two, slope and strength of the one. If some questions are there, then we'll answer about that. But now let us talk about the round trip travel time. What is it meant by round trip travel time? D, the distance between the satellite and the ocean surface is equal to CT by 2. C is the velocity of light. T is the time taken from the electromagnetic pulse to travel from the satellite to the ocean surface and back to the satellite again. It measures the time. Now the 2 is coming because we are measuring two-way travel time, and what we want is only one-way travel time, that is from satellite to the ocean surface. Knowing the velocity of the light, we can always estimate the this T. But the problem is, what I have written here is many corrections have to be applied to obtain sea surface height. Now, why so? Now, one is T is, you know, the accuracy of the altimeter. There is a clock. There is a clock in the altimeter. The accuracy of the clock is in nanosecond, the range of nanosecond. That means 1 by 10 times 10 zeros. Okay, 10 times zeros. So it is 9 times. Sorry. It is that much accurate. But even though the T is so accurate, but still, we have to apply many corrections for that. And that is coming because C, because of the factor C. C, what is C? C is generally, people say, it's velocity of light. Okay, it that is not a complete definition. Velocity of light in vacuum. Actually, whenever you define C, velocity of light in vacuum should be mentioned. Otherwise we don't have to apply any corrections. Now, this electromagnetic radiation, which is coming from the altimeters, is traveling to the atmosphere, which is having the water vapor content, ionosphere, and all those things are there. So all these effects of all these parameters like water vapor, other ionic contents in the ionosphere, they should be accounted for. That's why we have to apply these corrections. For example, in most of the recent satellites, very beginning satellites they didn't have, but in most of the recent satellites have the water vapor, radiometer, which measures the water vapor. So using the water vapor content, the correction because of the water vapor has to be applied. And some satellites have dual frequency, and because of that, the ionospheric effect also can be computed because of the dual frequency altimeters. Now, as a result of that, now we'll get this, if you correct C for the actual atmospheric transmission, then we can estimate D, distance. And that is of the order of few centimeters. It is, few orders of millimeters. Now, this altimeter operates in Q band, that is 13.8 gigahertz, and C band, 5.8 gigahertz. Some altimeters have both these two frequencies, 13.8 and 5.3 gigahertz. They told you this is useful to estimate. One is to estimate the rainfall in the rainfall from these two frequencies. Another way is to correct for the ionospheric effects, because of the ions in the ionosphere. These two frequencies are used, and it is not future, is already existing. We have one, India has launched one carbon altimeter working in 13.35 gigahertz. Advantage of this altimeter is 35 gigahertz altimeter is you can go very close to the coast because of the high frequency and a smaller footprint. Normal altimeters will have about 20 kilometer footprint, whereas this will have about 8 kilometer footprint. As a result of that, we can go very close to the coast, and even the coastal oceanography can also be studied with this carbon altimeter. Now, let us talk about the GRACE mission, gravity recovery and climate experiment. This is a very good concept. Nice idea, somebody has got it. So what happens is, there are two satellites moving together. This satellite, there is one satellite here, and another satellite here. These two satellites, they are moving in such a collaboration that the distance between these two satellites is maintained almost remain same. They are supposed to same. But because of the gravity, suppose when the gravity is more here at this location, this is get pulled downwards. Okay, and because of that, this slows down. As a result of that slowdown, the distance between the two satellites changes. So this distance is measured, and whenever there is a change in that, that is attributed to the gravity pull at this location. And because of that, you can estimate the gravity of this location here. Again, when this satellite, next satellite comes here at this location, again same thing happens, and it gets slows down because of the pull of the gravity. And as a result of that, the distance between the two satellites changes, and from this distance we can estimate the gravity of the Earth surface. And this is very very good and fantastic concept. And from this we can estimate what is the gravity of the ocean, and how much is water content in that one, and how much is the, and if you continuously monitor, we can also estimate the water content of the on the Earth surface. Now, sea level rise is not uniform. It is somewhere it is increasing and somewhere it is decreasing. Also, there are two reasons for that. One is the sea level rise because of the dynamic of the oceans. For example, El Nino, La Nina phenomena. During El Nino, sea level rises at some place, and during La Nina, sea level decreases at some place. So this, it reverse happens. And there is one factor of the oceans, because of which the sea level is not uniform throughout. It is neither increasing nor decreasing. Somewhere it is increasing, somewhere it is decreasing also. And the second one is the gravity, change in gravity. And you know, when the gravity is more, the water is pulled down. As a result of that, sea level will go down. So because of this gravity pull and the dynamic factor, the sea level rise is not uniform throughout the globe. Now, coming to the satellite era from 1993 onwards, we have very good working satellite ERS-1, and then TOPEX Poseidon satellites in 1993. Okay, and now we have JASN-2, OSTM. Several satellites have come up now. So we can see here all the satellites. Of course, you have to bring all these satellite observation to the same level, and all these satellites are showing increasing trend. this is the increasing trend in the sea level rise. I told you the recent increasing trend is 3.3 millimeter per year with an accuracy of 0.4 millimeter per year. Uncertainty. Now, this is the thermal expansion because of the thermal expansion, and this is the total sea level rise. Thermal expansion, I told you, we can estimate from the Argo floats. A change in volume because of the thermal expansion, and most of this difference, whatever you are showing here, is because of melting ice melting in the, from the land surface. Now, I'll just show you a fast movie on. How the altimeter observations and the Argo floats observations are matching. You just see here the black is from the altimeter, red is for the altimeter and black is for the Argo floats. You just see here the top panel how almost there is almost a match between the changes in the sea level rise. And of course, whatever is coming, a difference is coming back as already informed you, is because of the melting of ice. And this is gas can measure the mean ocean mass change directly. This corresponds to 1.3 millimeter per year. Sea level rise since 2002. And this difference is because of the, we can always measure the mean ocean mass change directly from the gas vision. And now just for the students, I can tell you that if the sea ice melts, nothing happens to the sea level. It doesn't decrease anything. But if the land ice melts, it increases the sea level. You can just see here, sea ice melted here and sea level has not rise because sea is already, ice is already there in the water. And because of that weight of the ice, the sea level has rise. Now if you take the melt of the ice, ice melt over the land, the sea level will rise. And as a result of that, the sea level rise, I mean, what I want to convey here is if the sea ice is melting, sea level will increase, but land ice is melting, sea level will increase. Now you see here the green Greenland ice sheet. If this, this is the sea ice, if this sea ice melts, nothing will happen with the sea level, but if the Greenland ice melts, the sea level will be increasing. This is one of the important factors. I think, should we stop now here? This 50 minutes I have already completed. Hello?
Yeah, I think you can continue for some 5 minutes more.
Okay.
Then we can ask
the questions. Okay, thank you. Yeah. Now, IPCC reports are there. Now, how the sea level is rising. They are showing here ultimately from the ultimate era how the sea level is rising and some modal projections and the additional land ice uncertainty. This difference what is coming here is because of the additional land ice uncertainty. I'll and semi empirical projections are also there. Global mean sea level evaluation is 1800. How it is going to increase the sea level rise, the different models have been run, and it is showing, I mean, sea level increasing. All the models are showing increase in sea level, but some models are showing a little bit increase, whereas other models are showing higher increase. But only thing is, it all depends on what type of inputs you give to the model. Now, what happens to the, if sea level increases, rises, what happens? We just see here on the left side and the right side, if this is impact of 1 meter rise above mean higher high water, if increase of 1 meter rise is there in the sea level, so much of area is going to be inundated. It will be covered by ocean waters. And similarly here also in the point present New Jersey, population getting impacted will be about 19,000. And in the Hampton, the population impact would be 146,000. Now it all depends upon the area where the sea level is going to rise. If the area is very flat, almost flat, the impact will be more. And if it is slopey, that means as you go away from the ocean coast, the sea level, I mean, rise of the level rise more slopey. It is more slopey, then impact will be less. If it is flat, then impact will be very high. For example, we take here two cases of 1 meter rise. it is only 19,000 will be impacted because the slope, there is a slope here in the, from the ocean surface coastal to the inland slope is higher, whereas in this other area it is almost flat, and so even 1 meter rise will increase, I mean impact more population compared to this 1 meter rise here at this location. Similarly, here in the Foster city, population impact will be 23,000, whereas here it is 146,000, 23,000, and here about 248,000 population will be impacted. You see here how much you compare the both left and right side panels. You see here how much area is getting inundated with the seawater, and it will be under the sea if the rise in sea level is 1.25 impact of 1.25 meter. So earlier one is 1 meter impact, and this one is about 1.25 meter impact. 1.25 meter impact, if sea level rises, so much of population is getting affected. This is one place at the one location. If you see the global scenario, this will be much more worse. Now in the same way, storm effect also will be more because you know the storm surge, you know the surge of water which is coming because of, from the ocean waters coming to the land because of the effect of the storm. When the storm is there, when the cyclone is there, it impacts towards it, it pushes the water towards the coast because of the strong winds there. And because of that, sea water will be coming to the coast. It is something like tsunami. Of course, these two phenomena are different, mechanism is different, but the impact is same. Of course, impact is same in the sense that tsunami impact will be much more higher than storm surge impact. But in both the cases, ocean waters will be entering the land surface. And if you a 30 centimeter increase in sea level rise would shift 100 years storm surge induced flood event to once every 10 years. What is meant by 100 years is, suppose a particular event is likely to occur in 100 years, that is 100 year return period. If the sea level rises by 30 centimeters, so this 100 year return period will become to 10 years. That means frequency will increase. Frequency of storm surge, impact of storm surge will increase. And the effect of the storm surge or cyclones for the coastal regions will increase. You know, the impact of storm surge will be different at different locations depending on the bathymetry of the location there. This is different. So models are already available. IMD is running those models. Suppose now you create a storm surge scenario of so much of wind speed at that particular location. The what will be the storm surge effect? How much water will be inundated to the land? You can estimate from the models, and it differs from place to place. It all depends on the bathymetry. Now, in different scenarios, 1 meter height, how much population will be affected if it is rises 1 meter? If it 146, so much of population will be affected. And if it increases, I mean, rise in sea level is about 10 meter, 10% of the global population will be affected. 10% of the global population is not a small amount. So we should be capable about, and this is also, I mean, I'm not showing details of that. There is a population growth is increasing. I have shown you in different countries what is the population growth. And because of the population growth in the earlier slides, carbon dioxide is also increasing. They are almost going one-to-one correspondence between population rise and the sea level rise and carbon dioxide. Now, I have only two slides to show. What next? Long-term sea level rise will be inevitable. We cannot stop it. Aquatic global warming and mitigation will depend on substantial reduction of the emissions. Now, we cannot stop the sea level rise. It is understood and it is accepted. It should be accepted. But what we can do is we should reduce emissions and try to mitigate the sea level rise. We should try to reduce its acceleration. That's what we can do. We cannot totally stop the sea level rise. And even with successful mitigation, considerable adaptation to already rising sea level rise will be needed. Even though, I mean, suppose there are two scenarios. One is we allow the sea level to rise in the way it is happening now. And the second one is try to mitigate it. Even if we try to mitigate it, we should be ready to adapt to the sea level rise, particularly in the coastal regions. We should be planning in such a way that if sea level rises, we should be careful in mitigating its effects. How we should control it. Now in the improved monitoring and understanding can contribute to better prediction, especially the impacts of extreme events. Extreme events can be very well prevented. If you can try to monitor it continuously and try to understand, oh, if this much of the sea level rise is there, what is going to happen? This type of understanding we have, then we'll try to reduce the impact of extreme events. Now, what is the future community? How can we reduce the warming, global warming? One is bring the sun inside, add natural light. You know, there is a greenhouse concept, green building concept is coming up, where we'll try to reduce the lights and we'll try to use the natural light which is coming from the sun. We'll bring the sun inside and the natural light. Now, conserve energy, use sustainable resources like unsustainable resources instead of using like petrol or chemicals or whatever it is. We should try to use the sustainable energy resources, like one is the solar energy, second one is the wind energy, tidal energy, wave energy, and one more is there. Ocean thermal energy conversion projects are coming up. We should try to use them and try to minimize the effect. Thank you so much. Thank you. Any questions, I'll be able to answer.
Thank you, sir, for this wonderful presentation. Now we can take some questions. Meenakshi, is sir, should I read it out
Sorry?
For you?
Yeah,
okay. Okay, sir.
Shall I come out of this?
Yes, in the chat box it is given.
Shall I come out of this presentation?
Yeah, you can get out. You can stop the presentation, or you can keep it on as you wish.
Yeah.
You can see the questions in the chat box itself, but Devulina can read it out for you. But if you read yourself, it will be better, I guess. In the chat box, yeah. Can you see the questions?
Questions.
Okay, sir. I'm reading out it for you.
Meenakshi is asking again to the RCP scenarios, high rise in SSP, yes. Seen in the Bay of Bengal. In RCP scenario, can you please explain how this rise in SSP will affect the East Indian coastal current and also tropical cyclone hit potential? You only mentioned about the two scenarios here, RCP 8.5 scenario. We are giving different scenarios how it will increase. Now this will increase the sea surface temperature. Not only sea surface temperature, you already talked about the heat content also, I mean heat potential, cyclone heat potential. This cyclone heat potential is very important parameter. Nowadays coming from the last 10 years or so, this is gaining importance in the cyclone predictions, because it is not the only sea surface temperature which affects your cyclone intensities. It is the ocean heat content. That is what is called a cyclone heat potential. What happens is, suppose the surface temperature decreases because of evaporation or whatever it is, because of the strong winds of the cyclones, evaporation will be increasing and SST will decrease. But the energy available in the ocean surface, subsurface layers, that is given by cyclone heat potential, will almost remain same. It will not will be affected by the evaporation in the ocean surface, whereas SST will be affected. So as a result of that, if the cyclone heat potential is estimated, and we can predict correctly when what will be the impact of the cyclones. And in the, there are many papers which have come up in the recent past, maybe 5-6 years, where a correlation between the tropical cyclone heat potential and cyclone intensity is much more better than the sea surface temperature and cyclone intensity. In fact, we have a paper where more than 50% of the cyclones show negative correlation between the cyclone intensity and the sea surface temperature. It shows that your cyclone heat potential at the heat content of the ocean is much more critical compared to the sea surface temperature. Yeah, next question, what should we take?
Thank you, sir. From Vishwajit Deb, sir, you can see, could you see that?
Satyam.
Vishwa, sir, could you see the question?
Yeah.
Or should I read it out?
Can you please read it out? Whose question you are reading?
Okay, sir. So he is asking this. Huh? Vishwajit Deb. Sir, just after Meenakshi, Vishwajit Deb.
Subrajit Rath.
Okay, sir.
Just a minute, Devulina. I request to pick up questions from the chat box as he wishes and answer them. whatever he wishes to answer. It's better if he sees the question himself.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, I think you are talking about Biswajit there. In the recent time, due to pandemic, total lockdown has been imposed in many countries. As a result, a significant decrease in the amount of SPM in the air has been noticed, and the air quality index raised significantly in many areas of the globe. So my question is whether periodic lockdown can be used as a tool to fight the climate change. It's a good question. But you know, what are the impacts of this lockdown? It certainly will do. I actually wanted to show that slide here, but I forgot to put it here. What happens is there is one cyclone recently in the Bihar Bengal, and that has come in May, right? If I'm right, May. Yeah. That because of this very clean atmosphere, what happens is the sea surface temperature has gone up significantly compared to the same month in the previous years. So as a result of that, your heat content in the Bay of Bengal has increased, and because of that, your intensity of that cyclone, this cyclone which was there in the Bay of Bengal in May, was not as it was much more intense than in the previous years. And that is because we attributed that to the pandemic effect, the lockdown effect, because of which the atmosphere is very clean and much more radiation has come from the sun to the ocean surface without any obstruction due to the atmospheric constituents, because there are no atmospheric constituents, no pollution at all because of the lockdown. So that intensity of the cyclones have intensity of the cyclone has increased, which was not at all there in that particular one in the previous years. So this I don't know, you will take it as a positive factor or a negative factor, but this intensity has increased, and with this higher intensity, if the more intensive cyclones come frequently, then the damage will be much more than the effect of a lockdown which you are talking about. Yeah, next question.
Thank you, sir. Sir, in the chat box there are questions. Sir, if you want to take any more questions, you may choose it from the chat box.
Yeah, human activities affect the sea level rise. Yes, human activities affect the sea level rise. One is by the human activity, we are increasing the concentrations in the atmosphere, greenhouse gas concentration in the atmosphere, and because of that, the radiation going from the earth surface is getting trapped. And because of that, your sea level temperature will increase, and because of the increase in temperatures, your sea level also will increase. Yeah, I think the next question by Devajyoti Gupta is also same. Do human activities affect the rise of sea level? This is also same. They do affect. Is the mass of transformation of polluted air possible from one continent to another? This is possible. I am talking about Suraj Kumar Rawal's question. This transportation of polluted air is possible from one place to other place, but it will not be that drastic because of the circulation of the atmosphere. This movement of this air pollutants will be there, but over a larger area, to larger extent, it is not be possible. It all depends upon the strength of the atmospheric circulation. Coming to the Satyam Agrahari question, as the sea level rising, is there a way to calculate the exact time when the flood will come, and will the city like Mumbai and Puri survive as the sea level rise very fast? And the question is, I don't know what you meant by flood. Sea level rise will have two impacts. One is it will inundate the local areas there. If the sea level rises, local areas will be inundated. I have shown you some slides and that how the slope, bathymetry slope effect will be there in the inundated area. And the second one effect is the sea level rises, and it is also because of the high tide condition. And if a cyclone comes in that during that time, your storm surge effect will be much more than in the normal condition. Is there any relation of global warming to sunspot? Sunspot activity, of course, it is 11-year cycle. And what we are talking about is on a longer time scale about the sea level rise and all those things on a longer time scales. But this sunspot activity is only 11-year cycle. It will be more and then it will be less. It will certainly affect, but not in the climate sense, the climate change point of view. Coming to the magnetic field is shifting towards Russia. Global warming, this magnetic field and global warming may not be directly related, excepting that your gravitational changes are there. If any gravitational changes are there, it will be affected, but otherwise there is no direct impact on that. Does globalization has its effect? Global warming, can you please explain? Yes, globalization is urbanization, globalization, they're all similar phenomena. Whenever the urbanization takes place, globalization takes place, and because of this urbanization, your albedo of the Earth's surface is getting changed, and because of that, your global warming also will be affected. What is the effect of climate change and ocean acidification? And is ocean acidification really affecting ocean heat content? This ocean acidification, basically you are talking about the salinity changes will be there because of the acidity, and this heat content is calculated using temperature. It is a product of temperature and salinity. So when the acidification is increasing, then the heat content changes also will be more. It will be affecting the heat content also. Recent solar cycle indicate lower solar radiation and cold future. Will it balance the global warming? To my knowledge, balancing of the global warming is not very much possible. We can only reduce the global warming. We cannot totally balance it and make the global warming zero. How assisting ocean heat content influence the cyclonic intensification? This is a very good question. This is my very favorite topic. How assisting ocean heat content influence the cyclonic circulation, cyclonic intensification. I already explained you just now to some one of the questions. SST, so far SST the only oceanographic parameter that is going into the atmospheric models like cyclones or even monsoons. But in the recent study we have shown, there is one paper, if you send me the your email ID, I can send you a paper, recent paper. Recently, 2 years back, we published where we have shown that SST does not affect that much the what you call Indian summer monsoon rainfall, whereas ocean heat content has a better correlation of the Indian summer monsoon rainfall compared to sea surface temperature. What is happening is sea surface temperature is very skin temperature. Skin temperature is a few millimeter depth. If you are using micro sea surface temperature, it is only about few millimeter thick, and this really does not affect the amount of heat available in the ocean. Whereas your atmospheric phenomena like cyclones and monsoons, they are affected by the total heat content in the ocean, at least in the upper 50 to 100 meter or even up to 150 meter depth. Whereas SST represents only the skin temperature, and even if during the strong winds, this SST does not represent the ocean heat content available. So my personal view, and we have also proved it through publications, that ocean heat content should be considered for cyclone intensification studies. We have several papers on that. I can send you if you send me your email ID. And again, I repeat, it is ocean heat content that is more important than sea surface temperature for cyclone intensification studies. Now the second question is, what does global warming have to do with rising sea levels? Yeah, this global warming increases the sea level because of the temperature. Because the temperature increases, your sea level also will increase. So these two are almost related. They have one-to-one correspondence between the global warming and the sea level rise. What do volcania have to do with climate change? This is again a different question. Suppose because of the climate change, volcanic eruptions are there. It is they reduce the incoming solar radiation because of the pollutions they put in the atmosphere, all because of the volcanic eruption. It will reduce. I have already shown you one example of Mercator volcanic eruption, where the temperatures have drastically come down because of that volcanic eruption. But again, this will be a temporary phenomenon. I mean, whereas the global warming is a long-term phenomenon, I feel they will reduce the global warming, but one side, but on the other side, we cannot expect more volcanic eruptions to reduce the global warming. I think all the questions are over.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you for this excellent talk and this long discussion. We are really very fortunate to have you here. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
So if there are no more questions, then we can wind up and we can start. We can take a break. We have a break, actually. So we'll join it.